The views and opinions expressed in the following program are those of the hosts and guests, and not necessarily those of the staff or management of Worldwide Digital Broadcasting Corporation.
Welcome to the Rise Above Show with Joe Peroni.
And Heidi Mancini.
And tell everybody about our sponsors.
Well, we just want to make an announcement that we still have some opening spots for our sponsorship. So if you're looking to have us advertise your product or service or you, whatever, you know, get a hold of me and we will talk about, we have different sponsorship packages and tiers and lengths and, you know, prices. That's the first thing I always hear, what's the cost? Hmm. But everybody, we can... You know, we have everything is customized to your budget or your needs and timeline. So, yeah, we're looking forward to some more sponsors.
And we're trying to get a good group of people together that want to go out there and help people. Mm-hmm. So we want to have a nice little army, so to speak. Mm-hmm. And if anybody out there needs help with anything specific, you can get in contact with us and we'll try to do a show on it. And I don't know everything in the world, so if I don't know, I will find out something that John does.
Well, and the other thing I wanted to mention was I wanted to, the website, the www.dbtv.com website, we are on that page, and if you scroll down and you find Rise Above Show in our picture, if you take a minute and you click to the right, there's a little part on the side that you can click there, because people have been saying they're having a problem getting to us because they don't know how to maneuver on that page. So if you click that right far corner, that will bring up all of our recent shows that we've done. They're dated, they're titled, and they're archived there for your listening. The shows are also archived at josephperoni.com, which is the website that we use for Joe's marriage and family counseling blogs. That's for personal training. And we also put the shows that we do every week on the Rise Above Show there also. So there's another place for you to go. And then one more place, we still have the From Grief to Relief page, which was formerly Rise Above. That's www.fromgrieftorelief.com. I still manage that page on Facebook. That page is there. There's also the Rise Above Show that's on Facebook. You can find us there. You can find Joseph Peroni on Facebook. You can find Heidi Mancini, my personal page, on Facebook. Our emails are there. Camellia1@icloud.com is myself. Joseph is bdillonesque@hotmail.com. And you can reach us there. You can private message me on Facebook if you need to. If you're having a problem finding shows every week on Facebook, I do announce the show prior to its being aired as an announcement, as an introduction. And I also repost that same show the following week as a rebroadcast. So I just want to share that with people because I've been hearing people say, I can't get to you. I can't find your stuff. So, you know, we're out there.
Perfect.
We're in a lot of different places, but the josephperoni.com site, your site, that Jimmy Gabbani, he was the web designer for that. Yeah. Everything is there. If you need to find us, you just go there, and all the information is there also.
All right. So let's start the show. So last week, well, we started a really great subject, and it's one of the reasons why I love our show, and I think hopefully everybody else likes it too, is because it was totally real. It's obviously unscripted. There were parts in there where we had a good little debate and brought up some stuff. So I thought today what we would do is we would continue to unveil, so to speak, or shed some light on childhood trauma of how it really affects us today. Because one of the discussions we had was, your decisions that you make right now, are you responsible for them? And of course the answer is yes. Mm-hmm. But about 85% of what we do comes from an unconscious thought.
Excuse me.
So we don't really know why we do the things we do a lot of times. So I've done some extra studying this week on myself. And what I wanted to do is prove in a way if I am totally like a calm, collected human being, or do I still get triggered from childhood situations? And I failed the test miserably. The first test for today we started with is, what happens is when you hit into the HIPAA axis, when you're adrenalized, you start to get that heart rate, mm-hmm. starts to come up. What happens is you start to go into the amygdala part of the brain. So it's all about the fear response. The more you're into the fear response, the less you're into the prefrontal cortex, which is the thinking part of your brain. So yes, you're responsible for your decisions, but your decisions get a little skewed based upon your emotional flashback, so mm-hmm. to speak. And so I would like to share with everybody right now, and Heidi already knows this, my resting heart rate from training is less than 60. Now, I don't know what it appears to be now if I'm calm, but my heart rate was 122 at the start. So my heart rate is already twice as high as it would be if I was having a conversation, let's say in my own house. So right there, I am already fighting some type of social anxiety from when I was a child. And I could go on about that part. What do you think?
I think you hide it a lot. I think you hide it pretty good.
And that's part of it. So that's why I wanted to bring some of that out today. But the examples that we used last week were Carrie Fisher, and we used George Michael. Mm-hmm. Because what happens with Carrie Fisher, they did talk about her bipolar, and then she died of a heart attack. Whereas with George Michael, they said it was drug addiction. And then you'll see this whole Hollywood thing where they're saying, it's just so courageous to talk about mental illness. And Carrie Fisher was applauded for doing that throughout her life. And I agree. It's an amazing thing to do, to put that out there, to say that, to make awareness. But she's missing one important thing, and I've noticed that all week long with all of this publicity about it, is that they want to talk about the mental illness, they want to talk about the addiction, but they don't want to talk about the trauma that it took to get there. And until we're willing to admit to the trauma and willing to talk about the trauma, we're not going anywhere. Because having bipolar or borderline, histrionic, anything you want to name, there is a genetic component to it. There's susceptibility for depending on your environment. But the truth is, it's not like having blue eyes or brown eyes. These things can be changed. They can be manipulated through correct facing and awareness of your childhood traumas. And that's really what I want to get at. The honest thing, and the total, it's honest enough and it's brave to talk about the illness, but just halfway.
But here's the thing, and I need to say this. I think that there's a point where you learn, okay, we go back to enabling again.
Right.
But we also go back to, through our lives, we learn to manage. Mm-hmm. Like, you don't even know. I think most people, and I'll say this for myself, because I have anger issues, I'll put it out there. You spend most of your life, you manage it. You get through because you're good at your job. You're good at your, I've always been good at my jobs, no matter what.
True.
Close relationships, maybe not, because I deep down inside, I've had trust issues my whole life, so I don't really ever trust anybody 100%. And the few times that I have in my life, no, I'm going to put this other, John's looking, what? the few times I have trusted people that were very close to me, they screwed me over. Mm-hmm. So I not only was screwed over as a young child, but then, right. You get older and you think, well, you don't realize when you're young that you were traumatized. No kid realizes that they've been traumatized till they start getting older, and one or two things are going to happen. They're going to have problems with relationships in school. They're going to have drug issues. They're going to have whatever issues that they start to draw by themselves into.
Right.
And most people don't even know that they have something that they need to look at, and you learn to manage it, and then all of a sudden one day everything becomes unmanageable. You're like, I've been living my life, I've been managing my feelings, I've been managing my response to different things, then all of a sudden one day, and you feel like you're going crazy. And I can relate to that, because I have been on antidepressants, I've been off of antidepressants, I did drugs when I was a little bit younger, the marijuana. I smoked cigarettes for years. Mm-hmm. I've medicated with alcohol on and off over my lifetime. But you think you're managing it, and then all of a sudden one day you're like, I'm not managing anything. You're just hiding really well till something triggers it. So that's one thing I want to put out there, because right. people say, there's nothing wrong with me. My doctor says that, you know, I have this disorder, I have that disorder. Well, the disorder is a symptom of something that obviously is much deeper. And I think that some people can go through most of their lives, and never have to look at their stuff, either because they're alone. They choose to be alone people. They are not, you know, they're alone.
Or they choose people as sick as them.
Right. Or like, and I want to put this out there with my mom. I'm going to say this. My mother is by herself right now. She's right. 70. She just retired. And I'm glad she's finally going to have a break. One of the things with my mother is my mother's chosen to be alone without a partner, a boyfriend, anyone in her life, because she doesn't not want to work at it. And she doesn't want to work at herself. She doesn't want to do the work to make herself, why do I feel the way I do? Why do I feel the bitterness that I feel? Why do I have such trust issues? Why can't I open myself up? She's old. She's 70 years old, and I don't see that ever happening for her. And it makes me sad to think that, you know, she's 70 years old, and I've tried to talk to my mom on and off about different things. But what I've come to in my life, because I have a daughter who I've had my own issues with, Ava and I've decided that I'm not going to be that way, because I'm not going to be alone when I'm 70, because I can't get along, or I can't manage my anger, or I can't manage, you know, my feelings and make it, you know, this is, and there, we're going to talk about that later. Yes. There are physical things that happen when you're getting triggered. You feel
122 heart rate right now.
Right. I mean, yours is like, yeah, it's like the heart rate goes up, the adrenaline. You know, I've said this to people. People have said, I have anger issues, and I'll address that. I'll talk about that. When I get mad and something triggers me, it's I can actually feel the adrenaline start. I can feel the anxiety in my stomach. My heart starts to race. I get a little sicky thing in my throat, like when you have phlegm in your throat and you want to swallow. Mm-hmm. It feels like that. And believe me when I tell you, there is that point of you have a choice. You can pause, mm-hmm. and that's something I still work on, the pause, or leaving the room and giving your, don't let your mouth run off before you're, because a lot of things are just triggers. And I'm finding that out just recently that, you know, and you, nobody wants to say it out loud. You don't want to say I'm messed up, or I have emotional issues, or I have intimacy issues, or whatever, because it makes it sound like you're a shallow human being, you know? So a lot of people are like, I don't want anybody to know that. They're going to judge me.
Well, it's interesting you say that, because, okay, so what I was talking about in the beginning with the Carrie Fishers of the world, mm-hmm. they're saying, okay, people like that are great. I'm not taking anything away from her, especially because she's gone now. I'm not going to do that. But she helped take away the stigma of mental illness. That's supposedly what she... That's great, but that's not the issue. The issue is, let's take away the stigma of talking about what got you to the place, mm-hmm. right? That's the issue. Like, sometimes we can say, oh, I have an anger issue. Like, don't we all? To be really brave, and I'm not saying to do this on live here, but I'm saying to be really brave, what we need to do is talk about why mm-hmm. the anger. Because anger is a symptom. It's not the cause. The cause is emotional trauma. Mm-hmm. Now, not to be the therapist here, but I already said it just in what you said your mom distances herself. She doesn't trust people. You told me you don't trust people. There's anger. I don't have to be a rocket scientist here. I already know the anger was probably aimed at you. It's what you learned. Then you got that whole HIPAA axis thing going when you were very young. That's what you learn. You learn how to distance yourself from people, because when you're naked, needy, and dependent, and you're 6 years old, it's not like you can pack it up and move across town. So you're going to have to figure a way to disassociate your brain.
But right? Here's the other thing. When we talk about, you know, every poor parents, like our parents get blamed for everything, always. Hmm. But that's so too bad. I'm going to say it. That's the reality. Parents suck, because, and the reason they suck is because they were parented. Okay? No, I'm just saying. Every parent out there sucks, because every parented was parented by a parent that didn't have the tools that they needed mm-hmm. for all of that. Okay? And it's hard for a parent. Like, for me, as a society, we still cannot wrap our heads around the fact that most sexual abuse happens in the house. As a society, we cannot get it. We tell our kids, it's a stranger down the street, it's that ugly looking guy standing on the corner that's gonna touch you. I'm not gonna go that high with the statistics.
No, it is,
but
it's about 95%.
That's what's reported, is 90%. We don't even know what hasn't been reported. We don't even know what's been reported because people are shameful. And the fact of the matter is if we can't in our own family say, this happened, how as adults can we say, you know what, I am somewhat responsible for my child's lack of emotional regulation, as you call it. I have something to do with that, because when I was raising my kid, I was in a shitty relationship. I was with a non-emotional partner. I may have had temper tantrums at times. I might have stayed away from home at times because I didn't want to go home. We don't realize, and I'm not saying this just about me, I'm saying a generalized thing. I'm a parent, I was married. We don't realize that, you know, our actions sometimes inadvertently, we put them on our kids or our feelings on our kids. When you say things like, you know, your father, I wish he was home more. Like, what's his deal? Why can't he be here? Why has he got to be out of the house all the time? You know, you're creating anxiety for your child just by a statement, even though you think, oh, that's no big deal. Your kid is sitting there, yeah, why is my dad not here? Maybe he doesn't love me. Maybe he doesn't love my mom. My mom is upset right now. I'm upset right now. And if this continues, then it leaves some type of mental imprint on you.
Yeah, let me just stop you there for a second, because all that's good. What happens is at a very young age, if you are born into a very stressful environment, what will happen is, just like anything else, if you have a muscle and you use that muscle, it becomes developed. Things you don't use are underdeveloped. Very simple. So if you keep hitting into that HIPAA axis where you're always adrenalized, what it does is, again, it pulls everything away from the prefrontal cortex and puts it into the amygdala. In other words, the prefrontal cortex, which is for reasoning and thinking, gets smaller. And if that happens from birth until you're 15 years old, what happens is the parents, or a parent most likely, takes this kid to go see a therapist or a psychologist or psychiatrist and just fix them. What happens is they go, oh, well, it's a mental disorder. You know, we can prove it. You know, there's ways to, first of all, you can't. There is no test that will show you that there's a chemical imbalance in the brain. I'm not saying it doesn't exist. I'm just saying that there's no test to tell you. So they have to go by the symptoms. That's number one. Number two, your brain does change according to the amount of stress that the organism is getting within its environment. It appears to be a disease. It appears that that person was born that way. So when we say somebody has borderline, when they have bipolar, you don't have leukemia, okay? It's not like that. It's what you can do is, really what it is emotional dysregulation. Your emotions go up and down.
But here's another one for you. The parents that bring their kid, I mean, I've had my kid in therapy too. And if you have a good therapist, and I know you are one, they take their kids in there, and the therapist I went to right away, they can't put it on me. I'm like, wait, what? Okay, wait a minute. I got my kid in here because she's doing drugs. She's a cutter. She's whatever she was doing at the time. And
nobody's born a cutter.
Okay, and the therapist says to me, how was your relationship? You know, and right away, but this is the thing. Parents don't realize that, okay, you're taking your kid to the therapist to get help. Fix my kid. But in the meantime, if they would open their minds to get fixed themselves, they could heal themselves internally for the other relationships that they have. Because chances are, as an adult, you're having some kind of relationship issues either with your partner, people that you work with. You're somewhere in your life, you're hitting your head up against the wall with something.
Absolutely.
And so if they would just be open to that, unfortunately, we have a society that nobody wants to be told that they're not a good parent. And it doesn't mean that you're an abusive parent. It doesn't mean that you're a neglectful parent. It just means that maybe you didn't have the tools.
Listen, sometimes things happen.
It just happens, right? You know?
Like if you take the ACE test, there's adverse childhood experiences. Mm-hmm. If you get a 3 on there, you're looking at a lot of trouble just from that. And some of them are very basic things. Like, did your parents get divorced? Like that little thing alone can create such a massive hole in somebody's life. Now, again, the parent could be doing the best they can. It's not their fault. They don't go out of their way to hurt a kid. Let's hope not. I mean, I know there's that too. But for the most part, everybody does the best they can. And it's very interesting because as you'll see adults, but they have egos too, right? And they have insecurities. They bring a kid in and they say, fix my kid. And you know that it's the faulty environment, and you start moving towards, hey, listen, let's see what your mistakes were in this. Mm-hmm. Well, 11-year-old kids aren't paying the bill, right? So no. The parent pulls the kid, and so they never get the help that they need. I shouldn't say never, but it's rare. It's rare that a parent can step up to the plate and say, you know, if it wasn't for A, B, C, and D, I probably wouldn't be in this position. And it's interesting what you said before. Let me just go back for a second. At some point, things become unmanageable. Mm-hmm. And that's very interesting that you said that, because if you look at like the AA model, the 12-step program, they'll say, well, you know, what is it? Like, my life became unmanageable, you know, with the alcohol, right? Mm-hmm. No, your life was totally unmanageable before you used alcohol to distance yourself from it so you didn't have to face your unmanageable life. And then the alcohol, you go, that's the problem. Right. No, alcohol was the solution to your unmanageable life. You pull the alcohol, you better start figuring out how to manage your life, because it really comes down to the trauma. Mm-hmm. You know, it's always first and foremost. And until we really want to have that conversation, nobody will do it.
And the trigger thing is, and this is what I've said, is that we don't even know sometimes what the triggers are. And people will relapse, and they'll go, well, I don't know what, and unless you have a good therapist that can say, you know, this is your trigger. This is what you need to work on. This is why, you know, once you find out why this happens or where the feelings could come from, then you could go, okay, I'm not a crazy person. I know now that this can get managed and why it's there. And you managed it, you put it down there for, you know, years, whatever you did, because you work your ass off, you're a workaholic, I'm constantly on the go. You know, I don't take too much time to
That's a trauma response, sit in anything, by the way.
You know, I'm always they said that to me at the salon today. One of the girls says, what are you on? And I go, what do you mean, what am I on? I was had hair dye in my hair, and I'm waxing a girl's lip, doing another one's eyebrows, and I'm talking about training, I'm talking about the radio show. And I go, what do you mean, what am I on? I'm not on anything. I go, this is me. I have been this way my whole life. Flit from one thing to the other, but at some point,
it's a flight response.
You have to put the brakes on, and when you're forced to put the brakes on and you have to sit in something for a while, it's painful. You don't want to sit there. You're like, I don't want to deal with that, because that's not me. That didn't happen to me. That's not me. I don't want to look at that. Or you don't want to look at a situation and go, how could somebody treat me that bad?
Right, and that's one of the things we could get into about how difficult it really is. Trauma is really hard when it comes from the family. You alluded to it before. You know, in our society too, we always go, oh, sex offenders, this, and this is terrible. It is terrible. But we always want to blame that really creepy guy behind the bush with the trench coat on. But that almost never happens. 95% of sexual abuse is inside the home.
And the sexual abuser has usually been abused himself or themselves or herself. I mean, some women do it too. It's not all men that do it.
Right. And that's the other thing we don't want to talk about. So let me add in too, when we talk about I don't want to let my kids go outside and play. There's a lot of violent people out there. Trust me on this. They're safer in the street than with you, because again, the numbers bear out that about 90 to 93% of the violence that your kid will be a victim of is from you. It's from either or your partner or the people you invite into
the helicoptering house. Honest to God, this was somebody told me this years ago about Ava, that I was a helicopter mom. I totally freaked out. I was like, how dare you tell me I'm a helicopter mom? I'm like the best mom ever, you know. But now my kid says it to me. She's 21 years old. She goes, Mom, she goes, you just never let me do anything. She goes, you were always there. You always had to drop me off. You always had to pick me up. You blah, 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 blah. And now I look back on that and I go, well, a lot of that was my projection, because I didn't trust people. So I'm going to protect her, because I don't think that I know there's some good people out there. I know that. I know that in my, what's that mind called? Like, you know, in the right mind, there's good people out there. I know a lot of great people.
The world isn't black
and
white.
But when it comes down to real deep down inside, you go, no, everybody's got something, you know. And she told me that the other day. She goes, you helicoptered me. She goes, but I, she said to me when she did say that, she goes, but I appreciate it now. But at the time, I ended up creating a kid that went totally crazy. I mean, you know, you were there, shaved her head, she was on drugs, she was just going crazy. And it was, and a lot of it was because of me, because I was like, I don't want you doing that. No, you can't go there. What time are you gonna be done? Yeah, I don't know. I mean, that could have been the right thing to do. It could have been the wrong thing to do, but now.
Well, listen, just like I was saying before, that's why I don't want to blame anybody. Mm-hmm. You did the best you can to the best of your ability at that time. There's no malice.
And that's what I told her. I said, listen,
There's no malice there.
I'm okay. I guess I would rather you say I'm a helicopter mom than an abusive mom, or I left you. Like, I never left her. I mean, I worked, I came home at night, you know, those things. But in some way, my behaviors or my residual whatever I had affected her self-esteem to some degree.
Yeah, for sure. Well, because when you're doing everything for her and not allowing her to do it for herself, of course.
Hurry up, get your stuff here. I'll help you with your socks. I got to get to work. Hurry up. I don't have time to be shitting around with this. And I would yell at her. That's how our days are. Hurry the hell up. I got to be to work. Get your shoes on.
You don't need to pick out her clothes when she's like,
oh my God, right? I was picking out her clothes. I'm picking out her clothes. Here's her little cute little outfits. And one day she was like, I am not wearing that. And I go, good. Pick out your own clothes. I'm not having that fight. She comes out with the most crazy outfit I've ever seen.
But now you know why. She was waiting.
And she was the happiest thing ever. She walked into school and she's like, I just picked out my own stuff. And I was like, you look like a dork and I don't care. Go to school.
But she was happy. And nothing bad happened.
Well, here's the other thing. What was the other thing I fought with her? Was when she was a lesbian. She told me she liked girls, right? At first I freaked out. I was like, oh my God. How did I make this girl like women, right? Like right away, it's about me. All of a sudden, I did something wrong. I made my kid a lesbian. So I would fight her.
You have that power.
And I'd say to her, no, you're not wearing a boy's shirt. No, you're not wearing those jeans. No, you're not wearing that jacket. You are a female. You will look like a female. You will dress and act like one. So what did I come home to one day? I came home to my daughter standing in the hallway with a wife beater on, pair of jeans, and her head shaved. Should you like me now? I mean, that's what she probably could have said. I think that's what she said. She goes, Mom, you like my hair? And that was a test. And I was like, I'm going to fucking kill you. I mean, that's exactly what went through my head. And I went, are you on fucking drugs? Are you on drugs? And you were at work. You weren't home. And I go, oh, my God, I can't handle this, you know. And
How did I handle it?
I started to come unglued. I go, you know what? She goes, Mom, can you fix it? Yes. I don't know what I'm going to fix, but I'll try and fix something. Because she had little marks in her scalp where the clipper got a little close and this and that was uneven. I'm a hairstylist, so I'm looking at this going, this is fucked up. Like, how could she do this, right? So he comes home, and I'm ready to freak. And she comes downstairs, and she stands in front of Joe. And he's looking at me, and she's facing Joe, and I'm behind her. And Joe's like, and I'm like, look at her hair. Look what she fucking did to her hair. How could she do this? And Joe's like, cool hairdo, Ave. And I'm like, but that's how he dealt with a lot of stuff.
You validated her choice.
You validated her choice. And then one other time she came in with a suit on, remember? She comes in, she goes, I'm taking my girl to the Sadie Sue dance, and she's got a guy's suit on. And I'm like, and Joe's again, he's over there going, cool suit, Ava.
I was like, nice suit.
So then she turns around.
You want to borrow a tie?
And she goes, how do I look, Mom? And I go, you know what? If you look great. I go, if you're happy. And I finally, she told me this the other day. She goes, and finally you just said, you know what? If you want to do this, go ahead. I don't care what you do. I finally got sick of fighting it. But you know, a lot of reasons I did that? I was embarrassed. And I was embarrassed by what my friends and my coworkers would say and people that were in my life.
Okay, so that's called narcissistic parenting.
Oh, yeah? I'm a narcissist,
Your child is not an extension of you.
Yeah.
In that sense.
Right.
They are their own entity.
But I was really scared. And, you know, and half of my family, they're still not okay with it. And there's a lot of people in society that aren't okay with it, but I don't really care. She's my kid. And I'm like, fuck you people. If you're not okay people, I don't care.
You know, considering we're talking about trauma, I shouldn't say this, but I'm having way too much fun. This is really bad. No, so I have so much information. Like, I don't even know where to go, but can I make it a little bit lighter for a second?
Yeah.
I'm going to throw myself under the bus. So here's part of what I did this week. I was trying to check how many times I was triggered. And I thought, okay, I know. What you have to do, by the way, if you get triggered, before you start making 50 mistakes, what you do is it's good to just sit back and understand, okay, I can feel it in my body. I'm not really feeling correct here. Stop. Breathe.
Stay with it.
Sit there. But here's the other thing. You say, repeat after me, I am experiencing an emotional flashback right now. That's it. because you know that the response that you could have is going to be absolutely and totally out of proportion
catastrophic
to what the situation is at the time. Mm-hmm. So you cut it back. I'll tell you where mine was. Very interesting. Very small, but it was still there. We went to a wedding. And it was
a very
great.
Nice wedding too, by the way.
It was a really nice wedding. And it was fun in every which way you can say.
Yeah.
But here's the funny thing. So we're at this table. Lady comes over, waitress. And I'm the first one. She comes to it. She says, "Would you like something to drink?" And I was like, "Well, if it's not too much trouble, I would like something." I didn't want to order it because I didn't want to tell her what to do. So she said, "Well, we have this, this, this," and then I heard her say Diet Coke. And I said, "Okay." I said, "I'd like to get a Diet Coke, but nobody else is drinking anything yet, and I don't want you to go out of your way." Anyway, so she comes back again, and the bottom line here is that it seems so small and nothing. But that is the essence of a little bit of childhood trauma. Mm-hmm. Like, why am I apologizing for having
a
need?
Coke.
I should not have to apologize for having a need or a want. Mm-hmm. And to make somebody go out of their way, well, it was her job. So what does that tell me? What it tells me is I thought, okay, I was experiencing something because I've heard myself say it. And when the words left me, and I do agree, it's a choice. So I am responsible for my words. But I was like, ooh, that was like very unconscious because that was not an appropriate way to act. Although it's encouraged because everybody is always like, "Joe, you're the nicest guy I've ever met. Oh my God, you're so conscientious and caring." I am. But it also comes from trauma. Why? Well, let's go back. When you are from a family that doesn't have a lot of money, you don't have choices. I don't go to the store and say, "Hey, I want this to drink. I want that to drink. Can I have the Jordache jeans?" Like, you get what's given to you, and you're happy, because if you are not happy, you're not allowed to show that emotion, because then you make your parents angry because they're angry at themselves for not being able to provide more. So I am stuck in the position at a very young age to manage an adult's feelings. So I become very good at being very loving, caring, and compassionate for other people. But to me, screw me. I could care less. Like, I go through long periods of time. I mean, I think I was about almost 30 years old before I bought my first real shirt for me. You know, I mean, that's ridiculous. You know, I was 25 and I thought I was starting to make money and I was so happy. I went out and I bought like a bunch of white socks and underwear. That was a major accomplishment for me. And it's like, that's sick. Well, when you come from a place where somebody says, here's some hand-me-down socks, that's what you do. The whole self-care thing, it's too indulgent. Like, I can't do that for me. I'll do it for you because I know you might need it and I want you to be happy. But I will take away things from me to give more to you, because that's the way my whole childhood was. Not brutal, not terrible, but enough that I cannot order a Diet Coke without going, oh, I hesitate, my heart rate goes, and then I say something stupid. And then, of course, I'm the first one she comes back to because I'm so nice, yeah. Right? And then it's like,
"This guy's not making me do my job. I like him."
Yeah. Then here's the next. I know, right?
Yeah. She's like, "He's gonna break. He's gonna
save." So here's the next one. So we have a couple, and they were really nice, by the way. I'm not gonna name names. They sat. There was like 20 tables, with like 10 chairs each. 200 people. There was no people yet. Like, there was nobody at the table, just you and I.
Yeah.
This couple comes in and they go, "You mind if I sit down?" My first thought was, can you not sit here? Because I am going to need to talk to you. And I am shy. And I don't want to talk to you. I'm not making small talk with you at all. Zero. I felt it. But what did I say? "Oh, of course. Take a seat. Right here, we're gonna have a good time." I'm like, "Oh my God!" Like that, you know, like, and they're like, "What a nice man." And inside, I'm like, "Can you please move?" Then I'm like, you know, I gotta go to the bathroom. So I get up and leave. Like, this is not normal behavior for a 50-year-old adult. You know what I'm saying? It's and it goes on and on. Wasn't that true?
Mm-hmm.
And after 10 minutes of talking, which direction was I sitting in? I didn't notice this. I didn't do it on purpose, by the way. So, yes, I agree. You're responsible for your decisions, but sometimes you don't know what you're doing. What was I doing? I had one leg forward, and the other leg was off. So when the lady was talking to me, I was like, yes.
Leave the other way.
I was like, yes, I'm a trainer.
He has his back to her the whole, most of the time. She's trying to talk to him, and he's looking at me like he's ready to escape, like I'm going to run.
Yeah, so pretty soon, I'm making this whole table a train, right? Because like I'm like this, and you're feeling weird, so you're starting to turn. The lady's talking over my shoulder like this. I'm like, hold it, look what I'm doing here. Like, nobody's noticing this, but I was trying to be real conscious because I knew I was going to, you know.
Well, that's why I kept facing her, because you were turning your back to her, and I was like, now I feel bad for her because she's, like, talking to us, and you're kind of, like, off to the side. So then I start turning like this, so I'm literally facing her, and I'm like this trying to have a conversation, and I'm like, I don't even know what's going on here.
Yeah, I mean, so in other words, that's not brutal, right?
But like, I don't know what's going on here.
But those are signs of early childhood trauma, right? Like, of course you're going to have social anxiety. You're going to be anxious every time you talk, because when you're younger, if you're put in a situation where you're not allowed to say certain things because you don't want to hurt anybody's feelings, you're not allowed to say, hey, I'd like the red shirt or the white shirt. You get the shirt that I give you.
I don't like it.
You know, the other ones that's on sale, or the one that you're, you know, you're whatever. And that's why you have this social anxiety all the time. You're trying to manage people all the time. So it becomes really, really difficult. It was, I don't know.
It was different.
Did you notice it?
Yeah, I did.
You did?
I just, but I don't have the, I didn't. You know, I was just kind of, but I'm pretty sociable out. Like, I'm not afraid to be talked to people. So I talked to the lady across the table, the guy over here, this one over here. You know, I don't really, I don't have social anxiety like you do. So I can't. But where I do feel it at times is if I go into, like, that's social to me. That's everybody's happy. It's a friendly time. It's a time to talk, share ideas, whatever. If I was to go into one of your counseling seminars, though, that's where I'd be a little, like, I'd be like, okay.
So listen,
I don't think I want to be here, because all these brainiacs in here talking about the brain and shit. I'm like, seriously?
But
I'm
know what triggers you?
Yeah, because I don't feel it, like,
what triggers you, and I'm
going
to tell you, because I'm going to take it. I'm going to take a
guess, Joe.
First of all, there's a lot, but but here's the first one.
But I'm smart as heck. But yet,
yes.
Right. Okay.
Yes,
I have to get that out there.
Yes,
I'm
but you
a
don't
dumb
believe
blonde.
That inside.
Yeah.
Listen, I'm going to say, I'm going to go out on a limb here, that your mother told you were stupid.
Yes.
Well.
Oh, and then not only that, I had a teacher in school. Miss, I can't remember her name, but she told me I was stupid too because I couldn't. She was yelling at me. Back then, teachers just yell at you. They don't do that now. They can't. They have no rights. But I remember standing up at the chalkboard, and I had to do an equation in math, and math was always my weak spot. And of course, that was driven into me a little bit farther that it was a weak spot. That's why I want to go back to school at some point to challenge myself to see maybe I am smart in math and I don't know it. But somebody told me years ago I was stupid, and she was yelling at me when I was at the chalkboard. What is wrong with you that you can't figure that problem out? How many times do I have to show it to you? So not only did I have my mother tell me I was stupid, I had my teacher tell me I was stupid, and then of course all the kids in the classroom are like, you know, because she, you know how kids are, they think it's funny.
Yeah.
So you think, okay, that's not a big deal, but that has stayed with me my whole life, and I've always said, I'm not that smart.
Hold
I'm not
it.
Smart enough.
Hold it. I'm gonna. That's the courage it takes to understand, to get better.
Right.
So let's say, because this happened on the air, by the way. I'll slip it. I'll go, blah, blah, blah. Do you understand? And you'll go,
what?
I'll see the eyes move. And I'm like,
eyes go like this. Oh. Did you just say that to me?
Yeah.
You did not just call me stupid. Trigger. He just called me stupid.
But
that happens at home. I'll go, what? And I'll turn around. He'll go. And I'm like, all of a sudden, that's what happens, right?
Right,
that
and
thing
I'm
comes
here,
out, and he goes, oh, no, this is not going to end well. Cause
and I'll try to slow you down, right? I'll be like...
He'll go, wait, I didn't mean it, what I meant to say. I'm like, I don't care what you meant to say. You totally just called me stupid. I'm not talking to you, you know, and then that's it. I'm off to the...
Oh, but look at what just happened there. Okay, the first thing I'll do, right? I'll go, hold it.
Jeez, hold
I'm
it.
Thinking, I'm not your mother.
Right.
Okay, I'm not your teacher. I'm Joe. Mm-hmm. Stop, breathe. I am experiencing. an emotional flashback. Right. This is Joe. And here's the funny part. You ready? This is how it goes. By the way, this show is great. Like, the reason why I'm telling you this is because I know a lot of therapists.
The other thing you said to me one time was, I'm going to ask you, do I have to explain this to you? He says to me, I go, what? You did not just say that to me. Hmm. I am not talking to you. How dare you? And then I'm off. Yeah. Okay, go ahead.
What I'm trying to say is that some therapists charge a lot. They charge like $150 an hour. And they just sit there and go, so, how do you feel? But I'm telling you, just one of our shows, if you watch it, you will get more than $150 worth of value easily, just even in just this. I'm going to tell you how this goes circular. Again, you ready?
Yeah.
What happens is you're ready to take off, right? You're looking at me like I'm your mother, I'm your teacher. And then you do this thing and I'll go, listen, can I talk? Can I talk? And it happens on the air, by the way. So it's very interesting. So if you think I'm lying, you go back over the videos. So what will happen is I'll go, can I talk? And then you could go back to the other video where I say, the only thing I want to be is seen and heard from when I was a child. So that triggers me.
Yeah.
Because I can't freaking stand not having a voice. So when someone doesn't listen to me,
that's his
and I'm right in front of your face.
So
going
that's
like
people,
this.
How
so
people
you doing it to me now.
That's how
you're doing it to me
start.
Now. Are you doing it to me now? I'm trying to finish the sentence.
Finish your sentence.
When I'm looking at somebody, telling them, please listen to me. I need them to be quiet.
This is where you hold their hand.
But you see, when I said be quiet, you
saw
talking.
I know, but you see, you hold their hand.
But you're doing it again. You see what I'm saying? Now, my heart rate is normal because I've been working on this. But it doesn't take away the fact that when I say, can you please listen, and you start talking, what part of can you please listen means I need to talk. Mm-hmm. That's all I'm saying. That's where the trigger thing is. Because then what happens is, here's the circular part, which is totally amazing to me. I've spent my whole life trying to manage other people's emotions. A mother, a father, this and this and that. So as a kid, that's too much for you. It's traumatizing. But it's what you know. And somehow, subconsciously or unconsciously, you choose people in your life where you get put in the same position where you're managing their emotions mm-hmm. again. So when I see you and I go, shh, I'm not your mother. Hold it. I could be 5 years old right now because I'm doing the same thing. I am also managing emotion. Mm-hmm. I am back to doing what my superpower was from when I was 5 years old. That's why I loved last week's show, because what it did was it brought out so much realism. That's why I feel let's do this, because there's so many things we do, and I don't mean we everybody.
Well, and the thing is that people, you know, when you do shows and stuff and you're putting things out there, it's like Facebook, you know, everybody puts the highlights of their life on there all the time, and it makes other people feel like shit because they're like, why this person has such an awesome life, an awesome relationship, how come I can't have that? Well, here's the reality, everybody's got stuff.
Oh yeah.
You know, everybody's got stuff, but it's shameful. It's embarrassing. You don't want to tell people, oh yeah, you know, we have some fights here and there. We, you know, sometimes don't get along, or we have a hard time working through things as a couple just because we seem like we have it together. You know, we don't. And you have to work at it, and you constantly have to, people change, people's situations change, their emotions mm-hmm. change, and you kind of always have to work at it.
Yeah, it's
and
difficult.
People won't think it's going to stay the same. It's like I talk to clients a lot too about that with relationships. Just because you start out a certain way doesn't mean that that relationship is going to be bound to that original structure. You know, you're going to be 10 years older. He's going to be 10 years older. You're going to have children come into the relationship. You're going to lose a job, get a job, make more money, make less money. The person you're with is hopefully going to mature and grow. And people have to renegotiate. I tell this to people all the time. I'm not even a counselor. I talk to my hair clients and everything. You need to get back together with your partner and let's go out to dinner and let's renegotiate, because exactly. What worked 10 years ago before we had kids, I'm feeling like shit right now because I'm sick of doing all the crap around the house. Mm-hmm. And this is what happens. And women, they don't tell you. They just walk around pissed off all day long, hating your guts. And the guy's like, what's wrong? I'm the same guy. I'm doing the same thing I did 10 years ago. Exactly. Maybe you are, maybe she's not, or maybe your life's changed and her life hasn't. So, you know, it's always a constant.
Oh, yeah.
And then you bring all the other problems in the relationship or the baggage. Mm. They call it baggage.
Baggage. Well,
let's see what I'll have. Baggage.
I want to take a break in a little while, but I want to say this one part before we do, is that when you start to look at yourself to start to get better, it's really hard. And not only that, you're going to make mistake after mistake after mistake. And that's okay, because there's another second coming right up and you get another chance to, you know, another chance at it over and over and over again. And it'll never be perfect. It's just like today. I get on the air, boom, my heart rate's going. Of course, I'm never going to be totally comfortable. I get that. But I can work through it. It's not a problem. And I'm sure I'll make a mistake today, tonight, whatever. And then I'll get more chances to correct. But here's something that's really important. I know Heidi will agree with me on this, is that when you're starting to look at your childhood trauma, you might want some people in your life to validate your position. In other words, a mother to say, you know, yeah, I'm sorry for yelling at you. Or a father that says, you know, I never told you I loved you. So yes, I get it. I'm going to tell you that if you're dealing with a narcissistic type person or a person that has a lot of insecurity, they're never going to admit that. So you're going to have to be okay with that. Mm-hmm. You're going to have to reparent yourself. And when you say that you're going in a emotional flashback at that time, you're going to have to talk yourself down and say, in this moment, I have more tools than I did when I was a child. Mm-hmm. And you're going to have to face it, and you will get better. But if you're expecting other people in your life to validate you or just somehow say I'm sorry to you, that may happen, but don't count on it. Mm-mm. So we'll be right back after these commercials.
I have a problem with New Year's resolutions, not because they often fail or because they're too difficult, and not because I'm bad at them either. I mean, I've only been alive for 4 new years. No, I have a problem with resolutions because people think that that's it. It's the one time to change. Now, don't get me wrong, we definitely all need change. I have no idea how to ride a bicycle and I live, but I have no idea what a toilet is for. And some of you, yeah, you probably should get out of the house more, but one big solution probably isn't going to do it. Sorry. So now what? Flush your resolutions down the toilet for one my little brother can't use? Of course not. Keep your resolutions, but go easy on yourself. Will you change? Maybe, but probably won't happen in one big moment. It'll happen in the thousands of little moments. Every time you choose to forgive or slow down, or be grateful or stay calm, each little moment that you choose what's right instead of what's easy, faith instead of doubt, love instead of hate, that's where the change happens. Even if you fail 1 or 2 or 30 times, it's okay. You've got thousands of more little moments ahead of you. You'll get better. So happy New Year, God bless, and I'm off to ask my dad to get a bike, if there were a pony. Bye!
There are about 2,000 kids in foster care in New Mexico at any given time. They're victims of abuse or neglect. And some of the roughest times are when they have to face their parents again. But as News 13's Gabrielle Burkhart found out, that's where a very special dog comes in.
A quick drink of water, and Emma, the golden retriever, is ready to start her work day.
Every morning she comes to work, she picks up her duck, and she goes to everybody's offices and greets them with her duck, and I think she just sets a tone for the day for all of us.
Emma is a certified service dog. She works alongside court-appointed special advocates, or CASA, in the Roswell area. They deal with children who are taken from their parents due to abuse or neglect.
Any given workday, we come across a lot of children that are traumatized or hurting or are in some sort of distress, and parents as well.
Emma tags along with children when they make supervised visits with their parents, who are often drug addicts.
And her job is to reduce their trauma. It absolutely works. The children, you can see them in high stress situations or even screaming or crying hysterically. And as soon as Emma comes into the situation, everybody calms down.
Emma's highly trained. She can pick up keys, shut a door, and she understands commands in English, Spanish, and even sign language. She also goes to court with child victims. Emma's handler says it's very important for her to understand sign language. For instance, when she's in a courtroom setting, Emma, come. Good girl. She understands commands without having to speak. She helps relieve stress, whether it's playing a game with kids before they take the witness stand or sitting with a 12-year-old girl in court.
Very sad, very emotional, and Emma kind of just switched gears and kind of left that play mode behind and kind of sensed what the girl needed at the time and just laid her head in her lap.
In Roswell, Gabrielle Burkhart, KRQE News 13.
Emma has been with CASA in Roswell for a year and a half now. She is one of the first CASA service dogs in the nation.
Welcome back to the Rise Above Show. I'm Joe Peroni.
I'm Heidi Mancini.
And we don't have a lot of time left, so I just want to throw in one little thought first and then just finish up here. And then we can continue this for like days and days. I love the subject, actually. But one of the things I want to get out is that when people tend to get together and they start having these emotional flashbacks with each other, a lot of people have this thought that, you know, I'm with the wrong person. Why do I get along with person A, B, C, D, and E, but when I'm with my partner, I get so frustrated, so angry, so tweaked, so much emotional flashback. But here's part of the emotional flashback. You ready? Let's say I have my things and you have yours. One of the things that hits you as an emotional flashback is intimacy. And that's what triggers it. Because when it's superficial, when I have a client in my chair and it's just another hairdressing client, or when I have a training client, it's really easy because you do your hour and they're gone.
Yep.
And so you become very good. So when you traumatize as a child, you become very good in the service industry.
Can I say something really quick? I know we got a couple minutes. I want all my clients out there to know that I do care about you, though. This is the other point.
No, I do too.
You don't want them to think that you don't care.
I do, but I'm not having sex with them.
But it's kind of like, right. You kind of go, I made you feel good. You look good. You feel good. I feel good because you just made me feel good. Everybody feels good. That's it. Goodbye. See you in 6 weeks.
Exactly. It's like,
or see you next week. Bye. Right. Have a good weekend. Go fight with your husband. Go fight with your girlfriend. I don't care. But have a great life.
But it's like Bruce Springsteen having sex with 50,000 people in one night, right? And then as soon as the concert's over, he leaves, and he's always admitted to having intimacy problems, right? You get my point. Okay. So let me say this real quick. This is going to sound weird, but this is, I want you to hear it. That's what, I got that problem too. I want you to hear it, so I'm going to make you hear it. I'm going to teach you how to torture somebody. Okay. This is the essence of trauma. If you have somebody that's a prisoner of war, a couple of things you do, right? You can be physically abusive, you can be emotionally abusive, and then you take away their basic needs. Mm-hmm. That's what you do. And the thing that you're doing there in a state of war is, I'm good, you're bad, I'm great, and I hate you because we're enemies. But the good thing about that, good thing, right? The good thing about that is that if you're the prisoner and you're the one being tortured, at least you know where you stand. You right. know where you stand. You know what's going on. You know this person is evil. You know they're coming after you. And you have no contact with this person in terms of expecting anything other than that. Here's how you really torture somebody. You do all the same things. You manage their basic needs. Food, water, close. You can beat them physically. You can hit them, let's say, emotionally. But mm-hmm. here's the kicker of it. Tell them you love them. That is what the problem is. Because now they feel like it's my fault. It's like, I need to say these bad things to you because at the core, you're bad and I need to change you. Mm-hmm. And so the person feels like, wow, this person loves me. I am an evil, bad human being. And so what you do is you invalidate this person. You're hungry? Why are you hungry? You don't need to be hungry. And you're totally taking away their reality. The reality is that the family might not have money. They're not going to tell you that. So they're going to say you are bad because you're hungry. You might want different clothes. You might like save a couple of pennies. You're a cheap miser. No, you're not. You're a kid who's saving some money. Mm-hmm. The family doesn't have any money. They feel bad, so they're gonna lay it on you. So that's how you torture. And what I'm saying is, overall, that's the essence of early childhood trauma is that they take away your soul because you don't know who you are. If you have to manage other people's emotions and feelings and thoughts at a very young age, you never know who you are. Mm-mm. You're always trying to figure out the sly way to get around so you don't get hurt.
You get your
needs met.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So that's the essence of it. A lot of that has to do with narcissistic abuse, and we can go into that more, but that's really it. So if you were going to create an environment to which to torture somebody, you would say that we're on the same team, but I'm going to hurt you anyway. And you can be 50 years old and still be hurt by your parents and still want to get that love because you have that biological connection. Mm-hmm. One last sentence. The evilness is that they leverage your biological love for them mm-hmm. into hurting you. So you always think it's your fault. And that's the essence. Until we talk about that, we're not going anywhere. I'm Joe Peroni. This
I'm
is
Heidi
the
Mancini.
Rise Above Show. Thank you.